On today's Sports Japan, we feature Battodo, the martial art of drawing the Japanese sword and cutting with precision. Practitioners believe that cutting with a real sword lends an air of authenticity and leads to heightened spiritual awareness. Today we take a look at some of the incredible techniques used to simulate combat.
Hello everybody, I'm Ayako Kisa and welcome to Sports Japan. Today we're going to take a look at the classical Japanese martial art of Battodo. We're joined by Baptiste Tavernier, a martial arts researcher from France. You came to Japan in 2006 to study martial arts and is ranked a fifth dan in Tankendo, fourth dan in Jukendo and Naginata, and you're a second dan in Battodo.
Yes, indeed.
Welcome.
Well, nice to see you again.
So although Battodo is a traditional Japanese martial art, I must say it is not familiar to the public.
Not really.
And today you actually brought, you've been practicing Battodo for 6 years,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
How did you get started?
Well, I used to do, and I still do, a lot of martial arts and Budo, and we always practice with bamboo swords or wooden swords. Mm-hmm. And after a while, you kind of feel that you want to do more and you want to go with the real blade. So
right.
That's why I started.
And you actually brought your own Japanese sword today.
Yes. So this sword was made about 300 years ago, and it cost about $4,500.
Treasure.
No, it's quite reasonable for a Japanese sword, actually. Market price can be way like $10,000, $1,000,000.
Really? Mm. Okay.
Indeed. Well, so let me show it to you, and we'll be really careful.
Okay. This is really
So the distinctive feature of the Japanese sword is called the hamon.
Hamon.
It's the small line, like waving line, you can see at the next to the edge of the, I don't know if we can see it. Here maybe we can see it.
Oh,
see
yes,
this,
I see it.
This waving line.
Yes.
And so that's where the steel is the hardest. And actually the interesting thing is, and it is why Battodo people don't use too expensive swords. It's because after practicing for a while, mm-hmm. the hamon tend to disappear.
It disappears?
Yes. If we look maybe back to the to the hamon, and you will see. We can see the hamon here, you can see, but
yeah.
Here it disappears and
right.
You can see the surface of the blade, it's scratched.
So that's the part you use a lot.
Yeah, it's the place where you cut.
Mm.
And to polish a sword cost about $3,000.
Okay.
So yeah, you don't want to use too expensive swords.
Mm-hmm.
And the second feature of the Japanese sword is the sori. The curve, you can see. Well, it is said that the more curve you have, the easier it is to cut. So, yeah, that's two features of the Japanese swords.
Okay, thank you. So let's take a look at the history and philosophy of Battodo and see just what kind of martial art it really is.
Sushi is loved by people all over the world. Using a sushi knife requires much skill. Tricks of the trade include the angle of the knife, the smoothness of the blade work, and an understanding of its characteristics. Battodo is the Japanese art of drawing and cutting with a sword. It also requires much skill. Competitors aim to produce the cleanest and smoothest cuts, slicing through straw mat targets that represent opponents. When the angle of the blade, the timing of the stroke, and the right amount of strength are combined, the sword achieves its maximum potential as a powerful weapon. The history of Battodo stretches back around 1100 years, and its roots can be found in Kenjutsu, sword fighting arts developed to train warriors. When peace came to Japan in the 17th century, focus switched from fighting to the training and self-discipline of the swordsman. This led to the emergence of today's martial arts spirit. Through repeated cutting of targets, Batodo practitioners strive to develop themselves physically and mentally in the pursuit of natural fluid swordsmanship. Techniques are all designed to simulate actual combat. The height of the target, or kakyo, for example, is approximately 160 centimeters, the average height of a Japanese man before the modern era. The target is divided into three major parts. These areas include the head, the chest, the lower torso, and the wrists. For most techniques, diagonal cuts of 35 to 45 degrees are regarded as the cleanest and most skillful. Through consistently honing their technique, Batodo practitioners seek to move in harmony with the true essence of their sword.
So just like Kendo, Batodo evolved from Kenjutsu. So what are the main differences?
Well, basically in Kendo, you're fighting an opponent wearing your armor. But in Batodo, since you're using an actual blade, there can't be any opponent. Of course, it's a solo practice. Right. And Batodo is pretty simple. You either cut or you don't cut. So that's kind of like fundamental philosophy of Japanese martial arts. You even win or you even lose, but yeah.
All right. So can you teach us some of the basics today?
Yeah, of course. And I came with Sugano-sensei, and he's going to demonstrate for us. So Sugano-sensei, yoroshiku onegaishimasu.
So Sugano-sensei is an 8th Dan Batodo master from the Japan Batodo Association.
Well, in Batodo, there are 6 stances, and Sugano-sensei is going to perform them for us.
Thank you.
The first stance is Chūdan no kamae, the middle stance. Well, Chūdan no kamae is the most basic of the stances, and it's suitable to attack or to defend. You can do both.
Okay.
The next one is the Morote Hidari Jōdan no kamae, the left upper stance. Why left? It's because the left foot is in front. And as you can see, it's quite an aggressive stance from which you can almost only attack, you can't defend. And also, it's a dangerous one because it leaves your body completely open to your opponent. So you have to be rather careful when you want to use Jōdan no kamae.
So this is more to attack.
Yes. And then Morote Migi Jōdan no kamae. So it's the same as the previous one, but this time the right foot is in front, so the right upper stance. Okay. So again, same aggressiveness and cut down. As you can see, a lot of things happen after the cut. And it's rather slow because you have to stay vigilant. You're not sure if your enemy is completely dead or not.
Okay,
the next one is the Gedan no kamae, the lower stance. Basically used mostly for defense. You can deflect your opponent's weapon, counterattack, parry, etc. So defensive stance.
Defensive stance.
Next one, Hasso no kamae. So this is a bit difficult to translate Hasso. We can translate it as eight shape. 8 as the shape of the Chinese character. Sugano-sen says arms are actually in the shape of the Chinese character for 8.
I see.
That's why it's Hasso, 8-shaped stance. Hasso no kamae is a bit more aggressive than the middle stance. So you can, it's good for attack, but still you can defend. Your body is not completely open like in the upper stance, Jodan no kamae.
So this is attack and defense.
And defense, but a bit more attack maybe.
Okay.
And finally, the side stance or waki gamae. This is also a stance used for attacking. And the interesting thing with waki is that you can hide the length of your blade so your opponent doesn't know the reach you have. So it's a bit confusing and scary for him, for your opponent.
Thank you very, very much, Sugano-sensei. Arigatou gozaimashita.
Arigatou gozaimashita. So, Batodo is based on these 6 stances.
Okay.
And there are 10 kata, or set forms, that practitioners train in regularly.
Okay, so having studied these basic stances, let's see a practical demonstration.
In Batodo, targets must be struck in 9 designated places. The left side and the right side of the head. The right side of the neck. The left and the right chest. The solar plexus. And the side of the torso. The wrist. And finally, the lower torso. 10 different techniques and combinations have been developed, and they all assume a confrontation between 2 equally matched swordsmen. The first of these is known as Jodan Sakidori, whereby the swordsman strikes the left side of his opponent's head. To make the technique easier to visualize, the swordsman demonstrates with a real opponent. We can see how the assailant avoids the opponent's thrust before cutting the left-hand side of the opponent's head. The fifth technique is a double strike, once to the right side of the head and then to the left chest. Let's see it again with a real opponent. Firstly, the opponent's attack is blocked before 2 blows are delivered, one to the right side of the head and another diagonally down through the left chest. Finally, the seventh technique is a combination of 2 blows. With this technique, the opponent's sword is pushed out of the way, followed by 2 quick diagonal blows, one striking upwards and the other cutting downwards. All 10 sword techniques in Batodo involve blocking the opponent's attack before delivering the final blow.
So there are no unnecessary movements in Batodo. It's nothing like the sword fighting in Japanese samurai movies or dramas.
Well, no, because movies and dramas are designed as entertainment. So of course not. All the techniques in Batodo assume a real battle between 2 evenly matched swordsmen. So there is no place for flashy moves and natural posture and stuff like that, you know. Batodo sticks to the basics and only utilizes the most efficient and appropriate sword techniques.
Okay, so once again, Sugano-sensei is going to show us some of these techniques. それでは、よろしくお願いします。
よろしくお願いします。
So what's going on right now?
So this is the Lei Ho, which you can translate as etiquette.
Etiquette.
It's maybe the most important things in Japanese martial arts is etiquette. He always starts and always ends with etiquette. Show respect to your opponents or show respect to your sword. That's why you bow in front of your sword. Okay, the first technique is Jodan Sakitori. You want to see in slow motion, maybe?
Yes, please.
So from the upper stance, as you can see, Sugano Sensei is cutting to the side of the head. And it's a really clean cut.
Very sharp, too. Mm.
The next technique is Hidari Keisa Do. So let's see the slow motion again. This time, there's a first cut to the chest and followed by an horizontal cut to the lower torso. Actually, the horizontal cut is one of the most difficult to perform. You need a lot of speed, and your timing has to be perfect.
It's very horizontal.
And the last technique we're going to demonstrate is Migimen Hidari Keisa Do. So let's watch it again in slow motion. While drawing his sword out of the scabbard, Sugano Sensei is performing a one-handed cut to the side of the head, followed by a cut to the chest.
Okay.
And then a cut to the lower torso. So that's the cut to the chest right now. A really clean cut. You can see the upper part didn't move. And then the lower torso cut.
The horizontal.
Yeah, which is really, really difficult to do. especially as the last cut.
Okay.
And let's talk about what's going on after the last cut, actually, because see, it's not finished. There's still a few things happening there. And this is called Zanshin, the unrelaxed alertness or okay. the vigilance after the last strike, because you don't know if whether or not your opponent is defeated, so you have to stay alert. Mm. And Zanshin is common ground for all the Budo, all the Japanese martial arts. So you will find Zanshin in Kyudo, in Kendo, in Naginata, in Jukendo, in Karate, etc., etc.
Very important.
Yes.
So I would like to ask Sugano-sensei a couple questions. So tell us about your mentality when you strike the target.
Hi. 緊張して体が硬くなりますと、平常心をいつも保たなくてはいけないですね。刃筋が狂ってしまいます。まず切る前に切った後のことをイメージして切る。切る気持ちが大事です。そういうことです。
Okay, so you need to remain calm because if you are nervous, then your body will grow tense, and if your body tenses, then the path of the sword will waver, and you won't be able to make a clean cut.And before you make the cut, you should mentally picture it succeeding. So you need to have the right mental attitude before you strike the target.
Okay. And what is the most important thing in Batodo?
はい。実は姿勢が一番大事なんですね。自分の体は常に相手と正対をします。そして自分の中心線は地面と垂直になります。それができるようになりますと、刃筋がいつも安定をして、連盟で指定しております同じ場所を同じような角度で切ることができるようになります。
Okay, so your body should always directly face your opponent. And the center of your body, the line center, the line of your body should be perpendicular to the floor always. You can't lean forward or lean backward. Mm. And if you can keep this correct posture, then the path of the sword will always be stable and you will always cut clean.
So your posture and you stay focused
is
very important. Sugano-sensei, thank you very much for your demonstration today.
Arigatou gozaimashita.
Okay, so now we've learned a little bit about Batodo techniques. Let's take a look at a recent national tournament run by the Japan Batodo Association.
Kashima City, northeast of Tokyo.Kashima has a special place in the history of Japan's sword fighting culture. Tsukahara Bokuden, the legendary master swordsman, was born here over 500 years ago. Today, more than 100 competitors have gathered here for a national Batodo tournament.Participants are divided according to their dan, or ranking. Of the 10 prescribed techniques, one is announced in advance. Two practitioners then perform the same action side by side. Three judges raise flags to determine the winner.Some participants are from outside Japan. Many women also compete, reaching the latter stages of the competition.
I enjoy using a real sword. Any lack of concentration shows itself in the movement of your blade.I've always loved historical TV dramas, but since I started Batodo, I've become fascinated with how to wield the sword properly to make the ideal cut.
In Batodo, judges focus on many aspects of the performance, including the angle of the blade, the position of the cut, and the quality of the cut surface.But thinking too much about the outcome during tournaments undermines performance, even for experienced practitioners. The winner in the fourth or fifth dan category is Teruhisa Shibata, Amidst the tense atmosphere, he demonstrates outstanding skill in the final. The advanced 10th technique is the selected technique for the final round. It requires three fluid cuts without interrupting the motion of the sword. Shibata's opponent in the final catches his sword on the target with his last cut to the lower torso, causing the target to wobble. Shibata makes no mistakes, drawing on the confidence that comes with hours of practice. His sword moves with great fluidity, cutting through the target with clean and precise lines.
Everything went according to plan. I was able to strike the parts I aimed for in the way I wanted. I think I've really managed to harness all the practice I've done.
What's great is people all ages take part.
Yes, indeed. Actually, in Japan, people, when they start Batodo, they are in their late 50s. Mm. The reason being that it's really expensive to buy a sword, so young people can't afford it. That's why.
It's a great experience for them. So tell me, what was so outstanding about Shibata's performance?
Actually, Mr. Shibata is a student of Sugano Sensei. And this time, as you could see in the video, he had a really resolute attitude before starting. He was really focused. And he did three nice and clean cuts, really nice. And especially the last do cut, the lower torso cut, was really, really nice. I mean, it would be difficult to do better than that.
Yeah, I enjoyed watching it. So, Baptiste, are there many people doing Batodo outside Japan?
Yeah, a bit in Europe, a bit in America, here and there, and in Thailand, in Taiwan. Yeah, you can find people doing Batodo.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that. So thank you very much for joining us today, Baptiste.
Yeah, it was a pleasure, as usual.
Please come back again. So thank you, everybody, for watching Sports Japan, and we'll see you next time.